suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth, and even forevermore. May the Lord add a blessing to the reader and doers of his holy
name. Father, we come as humble as we know how this morning, thanking you for last night rest, Father. Father, we come just thanking you, Father. Father, we thank you for the activities that you have given us the first thing this morning, Father. Father, when we stepped out of our bed, Father, yes. Father, we stepped out on two good legs, Father. Yes. Father, then you able us to walk around and look around and see everything, Father, like it was when you rocked us to sleep last night, Father. Yes. Father, we didn't have sense enough to go to sleep on our own. Matter of fact, Father, we didn't have sense enough to wake this morning, Father. You touched us. Father, you kept your angels hanging around us all night last night, Father, as we slept in summer, Father. Father, if we had 1,000 tongues, we couldn't thank you no more, Father. So, Father, we come this morning just thanking you. Father, we're thanking you for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Father, this crisis we're going through is just a test now, Father. Father, just to test the one that say they are your child, Father. And, Father, we just want to say thank you once again. And, Father, we know that this old world here, Father, is just full with so many evil things, Father. So, Father, you said in your word there will be days like this. And for the one that believes and trusts in you, Father, will have everlasting life. So, Father, we come this morning once again thanking you for last night's rest, Father. Father, we come thanking you for giving us a mind to come out to worship one more time, Father.
Yes, sir.
And, Father, you just done educated man so that we don't have to be all huddled up, Father. Father, you got something now where we can be spread it all over this world, where anybody that's interested in the word can hear the word, Father.
Yes.
And Father, we come just want to thank you for our pastors that we have here.
Yes,
Father, we thank you for our pastor J.P. Walker have led us in these 25 years, Father.
Yes,
Father, we thank you for the son.
Yes,
sir. Father, we thank you for our associate pastor, Frederick Walker, Father.
Yes.
And Father, just bless each one of our family, Father. And Father, just touch in a mighty way as only you can, Father.
Yes.
And Father, we know that you're able to do all things. All things, Father. And Father, there's nothing out beside all. And Father, we just want to say thank you again. And Father, we love you. We love you with all our heart, mind, and soul. And Father, we know that you love us because you sent your only begotten Son to be crucified. But on that third day, he rose. All power in his hand. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen and amen.
We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship Christ our Lord. Concentrate on him and worship him. Jesus Christ.
We give our praises to the Almighty God. We bless God for this opportunity he just gave to come to church one more time. Those of you that are not able to come to church, we thank God that we're able to lift up his name and worship him, as the song just said, that we're able to worship him wherever you may be. Amen. We want to thank our New Bethel church family, along with all of those others that are joining us this morning via Facebook. Amen. We want to thank God for our officers of this church that conducted our devotion, our minister of music, and our music department. Just thank God for all of them. We're so grateful to God just to be able to come to church once again. We give honor to our pastor, Pastor J.P. Walker, and our First Lady, Sister Florida Walker, and to my lovely wife that favored us with a beautiful solo, Lady Patina Walker. Amen. As we said on last week, we just want to continue to encourage you to continue to follow the guidelines that have been set forth for us through our president, our governor, our mayor. Amen. We want to make sure that we're following those guidelines, that we're continuing to practice social distancing. And let us remember to be kind to those that we come in contact with on this week. Let us be more willing to give. Amen. There are those that are on the front line. Let us pray for them. Amen. I just read an article a few days ago where former President Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton, they sent 400 pieces to medical staff at a hospital. All of us can do something. We are blessed to be a blessing. The Bible teaches us that it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. There are several ways that you can give. You can give to your local beautician, your barber. We know that they're going through some tough times now as well. Why don't you just send them a gift for a shampoo or rinse or whatever, although they may not be performing the service, but just be a blessing to them. I guarantee you that if you would share with what God has given you, God will continue to bless you beyond measures. Amen. Again, we just thank God for all of you listening in, but there is a word from the Lord on this morning. And that word is found in the book of Philippians. Book of Philippians, the first chapter. I ask that you will pray with us and pray for us, for we definitely need your prayers. Philippians, the first chapter, beginning reading at verse 12 to verse 18. You should find these words. I'll be reading from the modern King James Version. But I desire that you should understand, brothers, that the things which happened to me have fallen out rather to the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. And most other brothers in the Lord, coming confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed even preach Christ because of envy and strife, some also of goodwill. Those indeed preach Christ out of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds. But these others preach in love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. Verse 18, what then? Nevertheless, every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. I rejoice in this, yet also I will rejoice. Thus in reading the word of God, may God have a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and most of all the doers of his holy and divine word. Like you for a thought on this morning, don't miss the silver lining. Don't miss the silver lining. That term, silver lining, it is borrowed or is adopted from a phrase or an idiom which says, every cloud has a silver lining. There's a lot of symbolism. There's a lot of symbolism in that idiom or that phrase. That cloud in that phrase, it represents that which is bad. It represents negative. It represents the worst of things. And then the silver lining, it represents, or it is an indication that the sun is present. Although the sun is not able to be seen at that time, but the silver lining gives a suggestion or it indicates that the sun is present. The sun gives off light. And light is symbolic of that which is good, that which is positive, that which is beneficial. So in a nutshell, that phrase or that idiom, every cloud has a silver lining. That phrase simply means there's usually something positive or beneficial to be found in every situation, even when it seems overwhelmingly negative. Does not matter how bad a situation may seem, there's always some good to be found in. The author Norman Wright, he writes in one of his books dealing with crisis. He says that Chinese have a character for a crisis. And the character for that Chinese character for a crisis is composed of two characters. One character, it represents danger. The other character represents opportunity. This combination is seemingly appropriate, considering we have two options when we encounter a crisis. We can either look at or focus in on the dark cloud of the crisis and give in to despair, or we can see opportunity for growth and for change. And I just want to suggest to my brothers and my sisters this morning that we have two options before us this morning. We can give in to this pandemic, this crisis, this dark cloud, or we can see opportunity. Or we can see the positive in this pandemic. Now, I understand that it is a dark cloud. And sometimes, many times, the darkness of the cloud arrests our attention. But because there's so much darkness in this cloud of COVID-19. It has turned life upside down for us. It is a dark cloud. It has closed many of our restaurants. We can't go to work like we used to. Children can't go to school. It is a dark cloud. Sometimes we're focused in on looking at the darkness of the cloud until, if you're not careful, you will overlook the silver lining. Well, I come to encourage you and let you know on this morning that there is a silver lining. So all we got to do is just look for the silver lining, regardless of how dark the cloud may be. There is a silver lining this morning. As we look at our text, we see that Paul was able to see the silver lining around the dark cloud that was hanging in his life. This epistle to the church at Philippi. The Philippians, they were worried about Paul. They knew about the dark cloud in Paul's life. The dark cloud in Paul's life, well, Paul was in prison. He was in Rome, and he was in prison in Rome, and that was his dark cloud. And the church of Philippi, they were worried about Paul because of the dark cloud, and the only thing they could see was all of the bad. Paul writes to the church at Philippi to encourage them. Paul wanted to let them know that what they were witnessing, what they were hearing, all of it wasn't bad. Paul said to them that the first thing we need to know that if we're not going to overlook our silver lining, first thing we need to learn to do is what Paul did. Paul was aware of what God was doing in his life. While Paul was aware, he realized that the church at Philippi, they weren't aware of what God was doing in his life. Paul tells them in verse 12, he says, "But I desire that you would understand what I am dealing with, what I am going through, the things that have happened to me." Paul wanted them to know that it wasn't all bad. Paul wanted them to understand that those things that had happened to him, they actually helped to further the gospel. Yes, Paul understood what God was doing with his dark cloud. So he was able to see the silver lining. And my brothers and sisters, we need to see the silver lining this morning. Yes, I know schools are closed. I know that the workplace are closed, but there's a silver lining. Many marriages that were on the verge of divorce, now the husband and wife, they are coming together again. Families that were about to break up, but because of this pandemic, the family is starting to multiply. Children and parents, they weren't spending much time with one another because parents were working all of the time. But now they're at home with the children. Now we see that families are coming together. They are at home playing board games. They're playing Uno. They're playing checkers. They're dancing with their children. They're walking in the neighborhood. They're riding bikes with their children. It's not all bad, my brothers and sisters. And even the church, we're seeing some blessings from this pandemic. It's not all bad because Brother Kincaid, while I'm preaching to some empty pews, I'm preaching to a lot of views. Because many churches now have been forced to deal with the technology that we have been so blessed with. Whereas we were preaching to 200 and 300, we're preaching to thousands now. Because it's not all bad. There is a silver lining. Oh, my brothers and sisters, if I had a dollar for every soul that is hearing the gospel because of this pandemic that wouldn't have heard it if things were normal, if I had a dollar for every soul that was hearing it, oh, I would be a wealthy man this morning. But Paul, he was aware of what God was doing in his life. Not only was Paul aware of what God was doing in his life, Paul, he accepted what God was doing in his life. It's one thing to be aware, but it's another thing to accept what God is doing in your life. How do you know, Walker, that Paul accepted what God was doing in his life? Because when you read the text, you'll find out that Paul, he wasn't having a pity party because he didn't have a pleasant place or a pleasant pulpit to proclaim the gospel from. Paul was making, as Gladys Knight said in one of her songs some years ago, he was making the best of a bad situation. Paul, he wasn't having a pity party, but he used a prison platform for a pulpit and began to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Picture, if you will, Paul is incarcerated in Rome. Some say that he was on house arrest and he had chains on him. And on the other end of the chain, there was Roman soldiers. Well, Paul did not look at it as it was something terrible, but Paul used that for an opportunity to preach to the Roman soldier. And when the Roman soldier, when they would change shifts, that Roman soldier would go home and share with his wife and his children what he had heard from Paul. And when the other soldier went home, he shared with his wife and children. The wives, they shared it with their friends and their family. And before you knew it, the word of God was going throughout the city of Rome. All because Paul didn't throw a pity party, but he was aware what God was doing in his life. And he accepted what God was doing in his life. He realized that because he was there, the magistrates, the emperors, all of them were getting an opportunity that they wouldn't have been given to hear the gospel. Paul realized what was going on. He said that because he was incarcerated and because he took it on the chin, Because he took it with a grain of salt, because he took it with his head up. Many other brothers that were timid and were afraid and lacked confidence, they gained confidence by looking at Paul, and now the gospel is going forth inside the prison. He said that those other brothers, they gained some boldness and they began to proclaim the word outside the prison. Out of their love for Paul, Paul said that there was another group, that they were there to preach Christ, to try to pour on affliction to Paul. They were preaching out of envy. Paul said that it didn't matter to him whether they were preaching out of love or out of envy. Paul said it doesn't matter as long as Christ is preached. Paul realized that when Christ is preached, burdens are lifted. Paul realized that when Christ is preached, that tears are dried. Paul realized that when Christ is preached, that souls are saved. Paul, he said in Romans, the first chapter, Romans, the first chapter, around the 16th verse, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For he said, I realize that it is the power of God unto salvation to all them that believe, to the Jews first and also to the Greeks. So Paul is simply saying that I don't have a problem with being locked up. Because while they may be able to lock up my limbs, they're not able to lock up my lips. And I can still tell somebody about the goodness of Jesus Christ. Yes, Paul was aware of what was going on. Paul, he didn't have a problem accepting what God was doing in his life. But thirdly and finally, I see that Paul, he was appreciative of what God was doing in his life. Yes, because an appreciative person knows how to rejoice. An appreciative person knows how to give God some praise. So I stop by to tell you that while we're dealing with this dark cloud of the pandemic of the COVID-19, we got to learn how to be aware of what God is doing. We got to learn how to accept what God is doing. Because I read Romans, the 8th chapter, around the 28th verse, where it says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord in a call according to his purpose. Yes, my brothers and sisters, we got to learn how to be appreciative. Paul simply said, I will rejoice. Seemed kind of like ironic that he was in prison, but he was yet giving God some praise. Yeah, you don't have to be inside the church house in order to give God some praise. All you got to do is just think about how good God is, regardless of how bad things are around you. And you can still give God some praise. In other words, you got to learn how to look past your gloom and give God some glory. You got to learn how to look past your hurt and shout hallelujah. You got to look past your problem and give God some praise. He's all right. I know he's all right. Paul gave God some praises. Ain't he all right? I know he's all right. He's all right. Dark cloud to ever come around, because over 2,000 years ago there was another dark cloud on a hill called Calvary. But thank be to God that it was a silver lining around that dark cloud. How do you know, Walker? Jesus, he died. Do you know he died? But the silver lining is, it should have been you, it should have been me, but Jesus died a vicarious death. He died in my place, and he died in your place. But that's not how the story ends, because early Sunday morning, the dark cloud went away, and the sun began to shine again. I'm not talking about the S-U-N, but the S-O-N, because early Sunday morning, God raised him. from the grave and shout, I got all power. Even though he has power, he's alright. I know he's alright. Thank you, Jesus, for being that silver lining. Does not matter how bad it gets, I'll still shout glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down, I feel better, so much better. He's alright, he's alright, I know he's alright. Don't overlook the silver lining around your dark cloud. It may be that the dark cloud in your life, the darkest cloud in your life may not be COVID-19. It may be sin. It may be that you don't know the Lord and the pardon of your sin. Well, while Paul was locked up in a Roman jail, Paul also wrote a epistle to the Christians at Rome. And if you study the book of Romans, you can find out that salvation is there for you. Romans 3:23 let us know that all have sinned, come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 let us know the penalty of our sins. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And then Romans 5:8 let us know that God created a remedy for sin. But God commended his love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 10:13 let us know, for whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Jesus died for us, that we don't have to pay the penalty of sin, which is death. But you must be willing to believe in him. Romans 10:9 said, thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead. Thou shalt be saved. If you can confess it, you can believe it in your heart, you can be saved this morning. It doesn't matter that you're not in a church and you can't walk down an aisle and take a seat and give me your hand. If you would just pray right now, just let the Lord know that I am a sinner in need of a Savior. And I choose Jesus as that Savior, the one and only Savior. You can be saved. Do that today. Call your local pastor and let them know that you're now saved and you want to join a church. And I advise you to get in a Bible teaching church, one that teach about the Trinity Godhead, one that teach that Jesus died one Friday and God raised him from the dead. You can be saved. God bless you, and may God keep you. We'll pray now for all of those that's dealing with COVID-19, those that have been affected by it. Father God, we come right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Dear God, we ask right now that you will touch those that, all of us, dear God, because all of us have been affected by COVID-19 one way or another. But those that have been affected by it directly, dear God, that have contracted this thing, dear God, COVID-19, we pray that you will touch their bodies, that you will heal them, dear God. We pray that you will touch the minds of the doctors and the scientists that's trying to find a solution. Dear God, we ask right now that you will bless those that are working in the various stores, such as Walmart, Target, Family Dollar, Dollar General. Dear God, those that are working in grocery stores, Heavenly Father, we pray that you will bless them, dear God, for their bravery. Thank you, dear God, for their courage. Dear God, we lift up our law enforcement. Dear God, we lift up our mayor, our governor, our president, dear God. We pray that you move on their hearts and minds, that they will set guidelines that will be beneficial to our health over our wealth. Dear God, we pray right now that you just continue to touch our pastor, our first lady, continue to touch all of the saints of God, that are spread abroad, dear God, because of this pandemic. Dear God, help us not to allow social distancing to cause us not to connect with one another. But dear God, help us to use the technology that's available to us that will reach out to family members, that family will continue to grow closer. Heavenly Father, by FaceTiming and all the other technologies that's available. Dear God, we thank you. We praise you. In your Son, Jesus' name, amen.